and stand together as you're here with us as we open up.
Jesus Christ calls us out of the darkness and he calls us into light and light. I hope you've answered that call. And when you have, you know that there's freedom in Christ, and there's joy in Christ, there's reason to celebrate in Christ. And that's why we're here today, to celebrate the goodness and the greatness of God. This is also Valentine's weekend. Tomorrow's Valentine's Day. It's not just a time to celebrate romantic love, but the love that is from God, the love of the fellowship of believers, the love of friendship. Some of you have already commented on my heart pie, my wife Kay gave you this, I think, when we were dating. Wasn't that right? So this is an antique tonga. And I hadn't messed it up too much in 26 years or some years. So I hope you have a great time celebrating God's great love for us and how we can share that with others. So good to see you this morning. If you have not already filled out your information card, we ask that everybody do that. Fill it out. And then as you leave, there's some drop boxes in the back of the sanctuary. Just drop them in the middle along with your offering. You'll certainly do it pretty soon. We're glad you're here today. Glad you're joining us. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Oh, Father God, as we come into your presence today, we do come thanking you for your great love. While we were yet sinners, you loved us. You died for us so that we can know the freedom of forgiveness of sin, the freedom of life in Christ. And so we come into your presence today rejoicing, singing to you with glad hearts, singing to you our joy in being in your presence. Thanking you for that great, great love. Father, we thank you that we can bring all of our troubles, all of our hopes, all of our sorrows before you. And we find the sufficiency and the goodness and the comfort of the Holy Spirit to surround us, to uplift us up, to give us the strength and provide in Jesus Christ. I pray that today as we worship, today as we open your word together, we will draw near to you, as we draw near to you, we draw near to us. And you bless our hearts as we seek to bless you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Hallelujah.
That's why we praise Him. That's why we sing. That's why we offer Him our everything. That's why we bow down and worship His King.
Folks, aren't you thankful that Jesus Christ gave us everything? Amen? Amen indeed. He has been worthy of our praise, and we'll continue to do that this morning as we sing. Thank you. Father, we thank you for this day. Father, we thank you that indeed you are forevermore. You are the same yesterday, today, and forever. And Father, we give you thanks. We may put our trust and our faith in you. We have not. Father, you will never fail us. You will never let us down. You alone are worthy of our faith. In your precious name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Look, I am coming soon. My reward is with me, and I will give to each person according to what they have done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. He who testifies in his name says, yes, I am coming soon. Come, Lord Jesus, amen. Father God, for we give you thanks and praise. You indeed are coming again, and we look forward to the day when we will see you face to face. But until then, Father, may we seek to live our lives in accordance to your will, your way, and your plan. In the name of God, amen.
Take the Bible, turn with me to the book of Matthew. Matthew chapter 28. Such a sermon insert also from your bulletin. There are a lot of passages, several passages that we're looking at outside of Matthew 28. But Matthew 28 is a passage that's familiar to many people. It's been in church for a little while, and it's the focus of our study today on being disciples of Jesus Christ. Being disciples of Jesus Christ. Matthew 28. Beginning in verse 16, the scripture reads this. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw Jesus, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I will be with you always, to the very end of the age. That passage of Scripture comes at the end of the Gospel of Matthew, but it's also not just at the end of the book. It's almost as if it is the climax of everything that Matthew was saying in his gospel. So really that passage is not just the climax, not just the focus of what Matthew was saying, but it's really the focus of everything that is said in the New Testament. And it's also what is the focus of the entire Bible. We often call this passage the Great Commission. It is the commission that Jesus gave his disciples after his crucifixion, after his burial, after his resurrection, but just before he left this earth physically and ascended to heaven. He gave those that were following him a commission as to what their focus was to be as followers of Jesus Christ. I put this as kind of an asterisk at the top of your outline. We are to be disciples of Jesus Christ, and our mission is to make disciples of Jesus Christ. That really is the focus of the entire Bible, making followers of Jesus Christ as we are followers of him also. In the Old Testament, the nation of Israel were to be followers of God, and they were to lead other nations into becoming followers of God. Unfortunately, the nation of Israel in many ways failed at that mission in leading others to follow God. Today, the church is to follow God, Jesus Christ, and then to lead others and encourage other people to follow God and become disciples of him. But I'm afraid that we, in many ways, as the church, are failing in that mission. We look at our world around us and we see that it is increasingly becoming more and more pagan. It is increasingly becoming more and more anti-God. And sometimes we in the church want to blame the pagan world for being pagan. Blame those who do not know God and not following God for not following God. When we ourselves, as the people of God, need to focus on who we are to be as followers of Jesus Christ, and we need to focus on the mission that He has given us in following Jesus and making others followers of Christ. We're talking about being disciples of Jesus, being disciples of His, following Him, and leading others to become followers of Jesus. So we want to look at several things this morning on your outline. First of all, notice this, that discipleship is commanded. And the discipleship is being a follower of Jesus Christ and leading others to follow Him. Discipleship is commanded in the Scripture. In Matthew 28, we read, Jesus said, go and make disciples. That's pretty straightforward. It's also a command. It is an imperative that you go and make disciples. That's what Jesus tells us to do. And as we become disciples, He uses us to be instruments of God in leading others to follow Jesus Christ. There are many ways that we can be used as instruments, but a disciple is one who makes disciples of the followers of Jesus, and that is what He commands us to do. Also in your outline, 2 Timothy 2, verse 12 says this. Apostle Paul was writing to young Timothy in the ministry, and he said, and the things that you have heard me say in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to reliable people who will also be qualified to teach others. See what he's saying? Apostle Paul said, now listen, I led you in becoming a disciple of Jesus Christ, but it's not supposed to end with you. As you follow Christ, you're to help lead others in following Christ, who will in turn help lead others to follow Christ. See what he's saying? It's a command. It's not just for you to become a follower and that's the end of the road. It is the command that you, as a disciple, teach others to become disciples of Jesus Christ. So that's the first thing, that discipleship is commanded. This question, how you obey the command? Are you obeying the command to be a disciple, to follow Jesus, and lead others in following Jesus? And the second thing, discipleship is continual. Discipleship is continual. Discipleship is something I continually develop, and it is something I continually do. In other words, being a follower of Jesus Christ is not something to say, oh, well, I did that once back in the past. I think I did that back then when I was 12 years old. I decided to follow Jesus. But how are you following Him today? See, we followed Him, and we continue to follow Him. It is a daily thing. Christianity is a daily thing. It is daily following Him. It is daily making disciples and being a disciple. And in a sense, it's no real time in which we arrive at being a disciple, but we are continually being a disciple and continually growing in our relationship and our following of Jesus. For example, Philippians 3, verse 12, the Apostle Paul is writing, and if you think, man, if anybody has arrived, it's the Apostle Paul. If anybody said, well, you know, I can just rest where I am because I have a life, it's the Apostle Paul. But that's not how he looked at it. He didn't look at himself that way or think of his following Christ that way. Instead, he saw it as a continual process. Philippians 3, verse 12. Not that I have already obtained all of this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but yet this one thing I do, forgetting what is behind, and straining for that which is ahead. So I'm continually growing. And I am to be continually growing in my relationship with Christ. And then on the inside of your outline, Luke 9:23 says this. Jesus said to them all, whoever wants to be my disciple must take up their cross and follow me daily. So deny yourself, take up your cross daily and follow me. See, again, Christianity, being a disciple, is a daily thing. It is a daily involvement walking with the Lord. It is a daily involvement with people. It is a daily thing. We face temptations every day. We face struggles every day. We face opportunities every day. So it is a continual thing of growing as a disciple and leading others to follow Jesus Christ. And then, number three, discipleship is cultivated. It is cultivated. You know, sometimes we think that, you know, you become a follower of Jesus Christ, it's just automatic. You just start growing as a Christian, you start growing as a disciple. But that's not what we see. That we see that being a disciple is something that must be cultivated. It must be developed. Or sometimes we say to be a disciple of Jesus, there must be certain disciplines in my life. And as I practice these disciplines, it helps me to grow as a disciple. For example, look on your outline at 1 Timothy 4. 1 Timothy 4, verse 7. It says, have nothing to do with godless myths and old wives. In other words, don't get messed up in all the things of the world that can pull you off the track and distract you from the most important things. He said, but instead, train yourself to be godly. For physical training has some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise both for the present life and the life to come. For this is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. That is why we labor and strive, because we have put our hope in the living God, who is the Savior of all the people, and especially those who believe. To train yourself in godliness. This training in godliness is like, you know, I'm using the word cultivate. We must cultivate godliness in our life. We must discipline ourselves in the things of discipleship. And as we do that, it puts us in a position to grow and develop as disciples. Kind of like, you know, I like gardening. And, you know, if you've been in the garden, you know that certain plants have to be provided with certain situations or fertilizers or moistures or temperatures in order for them to grow the best. You can't just stick your tomato plants out in the garden and say, well, just, you know, do it. Because you'll find out the weeds tend to grow better and quicker and easier than the tomatoes and the corn does. You know, they're weeds. They're the things that just grow in our life. But the things that are important, they take cultivation. So I have to provide a lot of fertilizers, like soil conditions, like minerals, and cultivate those plants so they can produce fruit. And our life, we have to cultivate it. We have to train ourselves in order to grow as disciples. Don't just think it's just going to happen. It must be cultivated in our life. So don't forget, I must cultivate the discipleship in order to grow in our life. And there's several things that are involved in that cultivation. We're going to talk about them a little bit more in the next couple of weeks. But we have some of them already said, like our time with God, in prayer, reading the scriptures, having the mind of Christ in our mind and transforming our hearts and our lives. You know, our worship is cultivating our discipleship, reading the Word of God, worshiping one another, ministry is a part of the cultivating of discipleship in our life. We, you know, we encourage discipleship groups called D-Life groups in our church, and this helps you cultivate the growing of disciples in your life and leading others to be disciples. So discipleship must be cultivated. If you just sit and do nothing, the weeds will grow and not the discipleship. And then next, discipleship is costly. Number four, discipleship is costly. Being a disciple of Jesus Christ is not easy. I don't even think it's going to be easy. You know, just when I become a Christian, you know, everything's going to fall into place. So things will be, you know, coasting. You know, everything's just going to be great when I become a disciple. There are many, many great things about being a follower of Jesus Christ. It is the best way to live, being a disciple of Jesus Christ. But it's not easy. It's hard. It's costly. And increasingly in our world, the more pagan our world becomes, the more anti-God our world becomes, I believe it will become even more costly to be a follower of Jesus Christ. So costly, what do you mean? Well, there are many different ways in which being a disciple is costly. Not only are there the disciplines of a disciple that may cost you your time, may cost you some of your schedule, may cost you some of the things that are easier to do in your life, but it also is costly in regards to money. You know, being a disciple costs money. Being a church costs money. To make disciples, it costs money. It costs money to sit feed people around the world as our church is involved in doing, of training pastors and teachers to helping after disasters and hurricanes, tornadoes, floods. All those things are costly, and that's a part of following Jesus. There's a financial cost. But there's also struggles. When you decide that you're going to be a follower of Jesus Christ and that you're going to be a vital part of God's work in making others followers, guess what? It's going to cost you. You'll be a part of a battle, a spiritual battle. The devil does not want you to follow Jesus. The devil does not want you to be a part of making other people disciples of Jesus. He'll fight against it. There'll be some costliness involved in that. And also, increasingly, I believe, there will be a costliness that can impact our lives in following Jesus Christ. Look on your outline at Acts chapter 14, verse 19 through 22. The Apostle Paul was going around teaching, he was preaching, he was making disciples of Jesus. And it says, then some Jews came from Antioch and Iconium, where Paul was, and won the crowd over. In other words, they turned the crowd against Paul. They stoned Paul and dragged him outside of the city, thinking he was dead. But after the disciples had gathered around him, and no doubt they gathered around him and started praying for him, he got up and went back into the city. Let me ask you something. If you've been in the city and you've been talking to people about Jesus, leading some people to Jesus, encouraging them to follow Christ, and other people came there and they stoned you and drug you out of the city and left you for dead, when you woke up, what would you do? I probably would have hiked up in the other direction. Wouldn't you? I said, I'm not going back to that city. What did the Apostle Paul do? He went right back to the city. And the implication is he went right back to the people about Jesus. See, there's a costliness involved in following Jesus. Look at 2 Timothy 2, verse 1 through 3. We read a portion of this previous section. It was in the point number 1 when we talked about being commanded. But look at what it says in 2 Timothy 2, verse 1 through 3. It says, you then, Apostle Paul speaking to Timothy, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. Why do you need to be strong? That is Christ's confidence in life. And the things you have heard me say in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to reliable people who will also be qualified to teach others. And then don't miss this. Join with me in suffering like a good soldier of Christ Jesus. And you're in a battle. And if you're going to join in this battle, being a follower of Jesus Christ and helping others follow Jesus Christ, there's going to be suffering. See, I don't know how much we know about as Christians in America, how much suffering is involved in following Jesus. Many times we think of suffering when it's too cold or too hot in church, or when the sun goes 5 minutes long, we go, oh, I'm suffering, you know. Being a Christian, it was hard to endure that, you know. And, you know, we think of it in that sense. But when you look in the Bible, we see that the cost of following Jesus is many times high. Many people today around the world risk their lives in following Jesus and making disciples. Now, this is something that I really struggle a lot with, particularly in view of things that have happened over the past 2 years with the pandemic. You know that the average attendance in churches since the start of the pandemic is about 40% to 50% more than it was before the pandemic. And the simple basic thing of attendance in churches across America has dropped about 40% to 50% in that very basic thing. Because there's a pandemic. And I can understand that in many ways, but I struggle with it because if the basic attendance in churches, evangelical churches across America has dropped by another, the basic attendance, what do we think making disciples has done? If just the basic attendance has dropped 40%, how much do you think we've dropped in making disciples and obeying the command to be a disciple and make disciples? It's a difficult thing because I know God has commanded us to make disciples who follow Him. And the church can't stop being the church. We can't stop being the church when there's a pandemic. We can't stop being the church when there's persecution. Because Jesus said, I command you, make disciples. He didn't say if it's hard, or if it's costly, or if there's a struggle. So I struggle with these things. And I know many of you do also, because, you know, we've had conversations about what do we do? How do we handle this? But God commands us to make disciples, even as it's costly. Even when it's costly. But I don't want to get sick. Some people say, if I come to church, I may get COVID. You might get it. You might get it. And I don't think just coming to church makes you a disciple. It's a part, but at the very basic level of who we are. Because, as we're going to talk about, being a disciple about people, connecting with people. And it's hard when there's a pandemic. If you know of a way to make disciples that's not costly and risky, written, you know, I don't know the way. Not from the Bible. Because the Bible very clearly says, if you're going to be my disciple, and if you're going to live in this world and make disciples, it's going to be risky. It's going to cost you, not just in sickness, but in many things. I'm not a prophet. I don't claim to be. But from just what I see taking place in our country, just in our country, it's going to be a lot more costly for a person following Jesus openly, unashamedly, in the years ahead than he has ever known. I feel it. It may be a good thing, actually. Because the true church, generally in the scripture and through history, has flourished in persecution. Sometimes the persecution, sometimes the costliness of following Christ purges, and also, we are to make disciples, and it is very, very costly. And then number five, discipleship is communal. Discipleship is communal. I'm not talking about having a commune, but the idea, the word that I'm using it, is that discipleship involves the community of the church. It involves the community of the believer. You can't do it alone. There is a community involved, a communal working together that's involved in making disciples. Did you notice again the passage we read out of Matthew 28, verse 19? Jesus said, go and make disciples for us of all nations. And just think about that. Go and make disciples of all nations. He said this is a command of God. It's a command to us individually, but it's also a command of us as a group, as a community. Can I make disciples of all nations by myself? Did the Apostle Paul make disciples of all nations by himself? I mean, he went to a lot of people, but he didn't go to all the nations even during his time. The only way we can obey the command is when we're involved in the communal work, the community of believers doing together what we cannot do by ourselves. And we see this shown to us in many ways in the scripture. One is in Acts chapter 2. You know, in Acts chapter 2, we see, you know, Jesus is resurrected. The Holy Spirit came upon the followers of Jesus Christ. As we would say, the church was born. And we see how the church functioned in the book of Acts. During that transition time of the church being developed in the early work of reaching people, Acts chapter 2, verse 42, since they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of the bread and prayer, all the believers were together and had everything in common. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes, and they ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Now, I emphasize a word in there, together, because I wanted you to see the word together. They had a communal relationship. They did so much together. They involved one another in their following of Jesus Christ. It involved people in helping other people follow Jesus Christ. Now, there are many passages in the New Testament we call the one another passages. Love one another, serve one another, bear one another's burdens, encourage one another, pray for one another. Those are some of those one another together passages that remind us of a communal relationship that must exist in the believers in order to make disciples. And you see in that passage in Acts chapter 2, when they did it, the Lord added to their church only on Sunday when they met. Is that what it said? No. It said he was adding to the church daily. Why? Because the disciples were making disciples in everything they were doing. Talking to you. And you got to see what's happening. There's a communal relationship because the body of Christ was acting in relationship with one another. That's why the religion church is so important. It's hard to do the communal relationship of making disciples if you're not willing and not committed to it. There's a devotion to the communal relationship. And then on the back of your outline, discipleship is compounding. It is compounding. And by that I mean it is multiplying. True discipleship, as God designed it, multiplies. It compounds. John chapter 1, this is when Jesus was calling his first followers. And in John chapter 1, verse 43, it said, the next day, Jesus decided to leave for Galilee. Finding Philip, he said to Philip, follow me. And Philip found Nathanael and told him, we have found the one Moses wrote about in the law, and about whom the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. Nazareth? Can anything good come from there? Nathanael said. Philip said, come see. Just come, take it out. You see, Jesus went and said, Philip, I want you to be a disciple of follow me. But what did he then do? He went and he found somebody else. And he said, Nathanael, we have found the Messiah. I found Jesus. Come and follow him. He said, I don't know about him. And he said, come check it out. And what we said, they listen, then tell you something about Jesus. I come to church. Let the preacher preach about him. Let the singer sing about him. Come to church. If you have any questions, we'll talk about it. That's what we're saying. You see, there was a compounding effect. Jesus reached one, and then that one reached another, and that one was to reach another, and that one was to reach another. That's how discipleship takes place. It has a compounding effect. Sometimes, you know, a lot of people have the idea, well, you know, that's the role of the preacher, or that's the role of the paid staff. That's why the church pays the staff. They're the base of disciples. But if that is all that is done, that only the paid staff or certain people in the church are making disciples, the amount of disciples would be limited to how much me or the staff or a few other select people can do. But when each disciple who follows Jesus says, I realize I am to be a disciple that makes disciples, there's a compounding effect of the disciple making. That's how the world is reached. That's how communities are changed. That's how lives are changed. It's kind of like the compounding of interest when you put money in the bank. You can put money in the bank. Draw interest. And if you have compounding interest, then as your money makes interest, you start drawing interest on your interest that you made on the original money. And if that money continues to make interest, then it is also drawing interest. It has a compounding effect, so your money grows more and more and faster and greater and greater. That's where the kingdom of God is to grow. Each one who's following Jesus Christ is to make disciples. When you came to know the Lord, you would say, come and see. Come and see this Jesus. And that person says, come and see. And that person says, come and see. And you continually do it, saying, come and see. The church grows, the kingdom of God grows, and God is honored in the Lord's life. Discipleship is compounding. Don't fall into the deception that it's only something that certain people are to do. If you're a follower, if you're a disciple, you'll make disciples of Jesus. One other thing, this is not in your outline, we'll wrap it up with this. Discipleship is comforting. It is comforting. You know, I said it was costly, and sometimes we focus on that, but you know, that's a part of it. But there's no greater thing than to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. Did you notice the very last phrase in the Matthew 28 passage, where Jesus said, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things, obey all things I've commanded you. See what he said. And surely, I will be with you always, Peter into the enemy. What's he saying? He says, you commit to following me and making disciples of me, I'll be with you every step of the way. You know, if you ever wonder if God is with you, you know he's with you when you're making disciples. When you're committed to his plan and purpose for your life, the mission to be a disciple and to make disciples, surely God is with you. Surely God will be working. Surely God's hand will be upon you. Surely God's blessing will be upon you when you are making disciples of Jesus Christ. Two questions. I'll ask you that little one question. Are you a disciple of Jesus Christ? A second question is going to be, are you making disciples? But if you are a disciple, you'll be making disciples. Jesus said, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. Are you following Jesus Christ? Anybody here this morning? If you never received Christ as your Lord and Savior, we encourage you to do that this morning. Jesus Christ died for you on the cross. He paid the price for your sin. And he said, if you'll trust in me, believe in me, that what I've done on the cross is sufficient for your salvation, you'll be saved. All your life is following me, and I will be your Lord and your Savior. If you've never done that, we encourage you to do that this morning. No greater decision, no greater life than following Jesus Christ. And maybe there's somebody in your heart, on your heart, because we've been talking, that doesn't know Christ, they're not following Jesus, that God wants to use you to reach them. Commit that to the Lord. Father God, I thank you that God so loved the world that gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Thank you that you have guided us through a path of drawing people to you. It's the best thing. You'll be here Wednesday night. We're sitting in the book of Malachi. You and I have been chapter 3, so I hope you'll be here. Maybe just send God's word together. As you leave, don't forget to put your information card and your offering in the drop boxes by the back door. So if you're listening, it's a pleasure. I'll follow you.
Before we sing the choir, we will meet today. If you didn't get to join us last week, this is our second week. If you'd like to come join us, we'd love to have you. Meet with the fellowship call at 4, prepare our Easter musical. Let's sing together as we come. I'm going to go to the next slide.